The title of the series is found in John chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, right? I am the truth, and I am the life. No one comes unto the Father but by me. He is not a way, he's the way. If you find yourself in your life right now, that your life has some circumstances that there seems like there's no way out, I'm here to tell you there is a way out. And it's not a direction, it's a person. It's the Lord Jesus Christ. He is your way out. He's the God that opens doors that no man can shut. He's the God who shuts doors that no man can open. He's the one who makes a way where there is no way. And he is the one that makes all things new. I love that about him. So jump over to 1 Timothy chapter 2. It's going to be an interesting series for me because I could hardly say his name without weeping, because he means so much to me. He is the center of my life, and he's been the center for many, many years. And he just keeps taking me deeper and deeper into who he is. And he wants that for everyone, to know him. That is eternal life. 1 Timothy chapter 2, we're going to look at verses 5 and 6. It says, for there is one God and one mediator between God and men. There's one mediator. This Greek word mediator, literally it's a noun. It literally means one who intervenes between two for the purpose of restoring peace and friendship and also bringing a guarantee of a new and better covenant. He's the mediator. You know, you have peace with God today. He's not mad at you. Why? Because he condemned all of your spiritual death, all of your sin, once and for all in the body of Jesus on the cross. Jesus didn't say when he gave up his spirit, remember, no man took his life, right? That crucifixion didn't kill him. The Bible says he gave up his spirit. He died a real unique death. His heart exploded, right? Normally you die, how you die of crucifixion is you suffocate. You get to the point where you can't push yourself up anymore and you just suffocate. And because you get so weak because you've lost so much blood and all of that, you know, and all of the pain and all of the stress. But Jesus gave up his spirit. And when he didn't say it's about to be finished. He said it is finished. And guess who was finished? Satan was finished. Right? He took the keys of death and hell. Now Satan has no power in your life. Now we know he operates as an outlaw. That's why we have to stand against him. And we have to use the authority in the name of Jesus against him, right? To keep him at bay. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 5 and 6. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men. You know, I stand in the office of a pastor, but I'm not your mediator. A priest in a Catholic church is not your mediator, right? There's no human being that's the mediator. Jesus is the mediator. Because why? Because he's the way, he's the truth, and he is the life, right? It says here, who gave himself a ransom for all. He was the ransom. He paid a ransom. We were under the delegated influence of darkness. We were locked into spiritual death, and he paid our ransom to free us. So that's why whoever the Son hath made free is today indeed free. Who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. The New Living Translation does a good job in this verse. This is not a translation I would recommend as your primary Bible. I mean, but sometimes they get it really right. You know, the reason why I grew up with the King James Version, and that Elizabethan English, which kind of drives you crazy when you read it. See, some people, they really work on themselves to read faster. I've dedicated my life to read slower. So I love pronouncing the Elizabethan English, right? It slows me down so I could see some things. But what I like about the King James Version, it's a word-for-word translation. It's not a thought-for-thought. The New Living Translation and so many of the other modern translations are a thought-for-thought translation. Now, I'm not this King James only guy that tells you that every other thing is of the devil and all this other stuff. But, you know, rightly divide the Word of God. But I love this. The New Living Translation right here really hits the Greek very well. It says, "For there is one God and one mediator who can reconcile, call back into union," is what that means, "God and humanity, the man Jesus Christ. He gave his life to purchase freedom for everyone. This is the message God gave to the world, and he gave it at just the right time." You got to understand, Jesus, we're talking about the season when Jesus, the Word, that's his eternal name, unclothed himself with his godly glory, took upon himself flesh, and he was born into humanity. He wasn't born out of humanity. He was born into it, right? And he came to this earth at the perfect time, the Bible says, at the fullness of time. And you know, he's about ready to return to this earth. We're very close to his second coming. So we're going to talk about all of it. So Jesus was born a man. Why? To reveal God's love for mankind. Jesus lived as a man. Why did he do that? To show us how a man that is free from sin can live. Let me say that again. Why did he live as a man? So that he would show you and I, who have now been freed from sin, how we can live in the earth. Do you know sin doesn't have dominion over you anymore? Its power's been broken. See, before, you had your flesh nature and the sin nature. It was one with your spirit. But when you gave your heart to Christ, the Holy Spirit came into your physical body, came in, and he circumcised you. So he cut your dead spirit away from this dead nature in your flesh and removed it completely. Your old man is gone. And then he put a new spirit in that physical body. But what he did, he didn't put it back like this. He put it like this. So now the sin nature's separate. So that's why sin won't dominate you anymore, right? So that's why he lived as a man. Jesus died as a man. Why? To take our place, to pay for our sin, to bear our sin nature, to bear our sins along with it, to bear all of our sicknesses, diseases, pain, poverty, and lack. That's why he died as a man. Jesus was raised from the dead as a man. Okay? Let's go to Colossians chapter 1, verse 18. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 18. It says, "And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence." He raised us up with him, right? Have you ever heard of this scripture, John 3:16, right? "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting Zoe life," the life of God. So Jesus was born and humanity was changed forever. If you'll notice in the earth today, people have no problem with a lot of the other religions in this earth, but they always seem to have a problem with Christianity, right? Because see, in the Hindu religion, there are many, many ways to God. You've got the Buddhist, who it's more of a philosophy, right? You've got Muhammad and the whole Muslim thing going on. You've got all the different cults and everything. But Jesus, it's the only one. He has an empty tomb. He's alive today. He's the creator of all things. And he paid your price. So this Christmas season, I would encourage you, don't make it about Santa. Santa's cool. Toys are cool. But bring it the reality of what this season is all about. It's all about Jesus Christ came to this earth and redeemed us and brought us freedom. See, God's intent was to end religion and restore relationship. That's what his intent is. Well, that'll upset some people. He opened the door for all mankind to live days of heaven on this earth. He brought the kingdom of God back to this earth. Everything Adam had lost, had given up, Jesus brought it all back and more. The Bible says that what Satan did to humanity through Adam's sin cannot even be compared to what God the Father did through his son Jesus in his redemptive work. It can't even be compared. So Jesus Christ, his life did not begin when he was born, okay? The Word is his eternal name. In John 1:1, it says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. It goes on to say in 1 John chapter 1, in verse 1, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon and our hands have handled of the Word of life. Jesus is the Word of life. He's not the Word of condemnation. He's not the Word of I'm going to get you, right? It's the Word of life. Everything about him brings you into freedom. Everything about religion will bind you. The reason why it binds you is because you can't be good enough to be accepted by him. It's not about that. Good people don't go to heaven. Bad people don't go to hell. It's not about that. Why does a man sin? Because they're spiritually dead. Why will I spend eternity in heaven, in the presence of God, and have purpose and destiny in all eternity? Why? Because I'm good? Oh, no. No, I would have split hell wide open. Right? So would every other human being. So give yourself a break. You've been redeemed. Right? The only reason why I'm going to be able to stand before a holy God face to face in his presence, the only reason is because I simply believed what he said. And I was made the righteousness of Almighty God in Christ because I simply believed it. So through faith, could never be earned. Wow. Doesn't that just free you even hearing that? Revelation chapter 19, verse 13, we said his eternal name is the Word of God. It says, and he was clothed with a vesture, which is a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. This is Jesus. To know him, you will know him through his Word. And he's put his Spirit in you so that you could know him and walk with him. I love that. So, Jesus, one of the things about him is he is the creator of what? The universe, of everything, right? I wonder if he could help your life right now. I wonder if he could help you kind of get ahead financially, maybe. I wonder if he could help you deal with your relatives this Christmas season, right? Right? I wonder if he could help you deal with yourself. I wonder if his mercy is maybe greater than your disobedience, right? So in John chapter 1, verse 3, it says this. John 1:3, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. He was in the world, verse 10, we jump from verse 3, let's go to verse 10. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. Isn't that interesting? The baby that was laid in a manger was laid, Jesus, the creator of the universe, was laid in a manger on the planet that he created. Right? Right? Wrap your mind around that one. So Colossians chapter 1 in verse 16 says this. Colossians 1:16, "For by him were all things created that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible and invisible." Did you know there's invisible things that are created? Isn't that awesome? "Whether they be thrones, dominions, principalities, or powers, all things were created by him and for him." Well, now, wait a minute, Pastor. Are you kidding me? So he created Satan, and he created all the demons, and he created all the fallen angels, all the principalities and powers, rulers of the darkness of this world. He created all of them? Yes. But now, let me clarify. He didn't create them in that state. He created Satan, but he created him Lucifer. He was an archangel. He led worship in heaven. Lucifer made the choice. All the demonic powers that we have, they weren't created demonic powers. Right? That, you realize that's being taught with no scriptural basis for it at all. So let's keep going with this. Jesus came into the world as the incarnate Word of God. He was the incarnate Word. What does that word incarnate mean? Right? I'm so glad you asked. It means clothed in flesh. Okay? Jesus came again into humanity. He was not born out of humanity. He was alive way, way before he laid in a manger. Why am I saying all these things? Because he's bigger than anything you'll ever face. He is the answer for the world. He's your answer. He's the answer for the whole world. And if the more you'll just open your heart to him, the more he can work in your life. There are 333 Old Testament prophecies that have within them 456 specific details about the birth, the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus. Every one of them have been fulfilled. The crazy thing is there's over 600 prophecies about his second coming. There's almost double about his second coming. Wow. I wonder if that's going to happen. Oh, it's going to happen. So go over to Matthew chapter 1. Matthew chapter 1. Let's start in verse 23. You guys doing good this morning? Has the tryptophan wore off? You guys look pretty awake. That's good. That's so good. Maybe not this afternoon when you have leftovers, right? Matthew chapter 1, verse 23. It says, "Behold, a virgin," and literally in the Greek it would say, "Behold, the virgin." There's only been one. "Shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us." If you look at the Greek word Emmanuel, it literally means God with us in a new way. That's literally what that means. In Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6, it says this, Isaiah 9 verse 6, "For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called," wonderful, "Counselor," I love this one, "the mighty God." That word mighty literally in the Hebrew means hero God. He's our hero. "The everlasting Father and the Prince of Peace." I'm very fond of this scripture in Micah chapter 5 and verse 2. It says, "But you, Bethlehem, Ephratah," look at this, "though you are little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of you shall come forth to me the one to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth are from old, from everlasting." He was alive way before he was born in a manger. Do you realize this was prophesied 400 years before the birth of Jesus. When it was prophesied, there was no Bethlehem Ephratah. There was only a Bethlehem Zebulun. But you know what? God is the God who calls the end from the beginning, right? Do you know the Bible's the only book, the only religious book, if you want to classify it as that, that tells the future? God says that's the difference between him and any of these other so-called gods. He tells the end from the beginning, right? So that's why you can know the end of your situation before you get there. If you have some sickness going on in your body, you already know the end result. He's provided healing. So what he has done has to bow, or it will cause to bow whatever sickness and disease that's in your body. The name of Jesus is above everything. He has been given a name above everything. So in John chapter 1 and verse 14, it says, "And the Word was made flesh." It literally in the Greek would read like this, "And the Word took upon himself flesh and dwelt among us." And then it says, "And we beheld his glory," the glory of God. This word glory means his goodness, his power, his presence. "We beheld his glory." It was the glory as of the only begotten of the Father. He was full of grace. He was full of truth. I love that. So in Matthew chapter 1 in verse 21, is your pen smoking yet? Matthew chapter 1, verse 21, "And he shall bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus." Why? "He will save his people from their sins." I love this verse because that means we're his people. Man, isn't that awesome? He saved us. Luke chapter 1, in verse 31, it says, "And behold, you shall conceive in your womb and bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus." So if you want the New Testament name, his name is the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord. The Lord is the name of his deity. It shows ownership. If you are a child of God, he's your Lord. He owns you. Aren't you glad? Right? My life is not my own. When the Lord would talk to me about my body, getting my body in shape, he's saying, "Your body, Tony, which belongs to me." That's the way he would always say it. Do you know what the Bible says? Glorify God in your spirit, right? And in your body, which belongs to him. I love that. Jesus is the name of his humanity. Jesus literally means Savior. Christ is the name of his office. In the Hebrew word for Christ is Messiah. The Greek word for Christ, guess what that is? It's Christ. I just thought I'd wake you guys up. There we go. But it literally means in both the Messiah or Christ, it means the anointed one and his anointing that he brings. He is Jesus Christ, right? So let's go to Philippians chapter 2. We'll slow down a little bit and let's look at this. You know, I'm giving you guys a great tool to take these scriptures, write them down, and share them with people. You'd be amazed at what happens. Philippians chapter 2, we'll start in verse 5 and we'll read through verse 8. Look at what it says. It says, "Let this mind be in you." In other words, the Word of God is saying, "I want you to think this way." "That was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God." Jesus knew who he was, but yet he made himself of no reputation. Man, I am so... It is so awesome that I have decided to make myself of no reputation. Having a reputation just, ugh, no life in it, right? He made himself of no reputation. This word literally, reputation in the Greek, means he emptied himself. He made himself of no effect. That's amazing. He literally let go of everything to come to this earth. Took upon himself the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. It's interesting. It says he was made in the likeness of men. So in other words, he was made like man, but without a sin nature. Jesus had no sin nature. He was not born in sin. That's why it says in the likeness of men. I love that. And being found in fashion, this word fashion literally means, and being found in his manner of life as a man, he humbled himself. Do you know God never humbles anybody? You must humble yourself. The Bible never says he'll humble you. Lord, make me humble. God's going to go, no, you got to humble yourself, right? He humbled himself and became obedient unto death. He became obedient all the way to physical death, even the death of the cross, spiritual death. If you have in your Bible, he became obedient to death. That's talking about he physically died. But then also the death of the cross, it speaks about two deaths. Did Jesus die spiritually? Well, if you define spiritual death as being separated from his Father, he was separated from his Father, we know, for 3 hours when he paid the price for the weight and judgment of all the world. We have no idea. The Bible says when all of the weight and judgment of all the sin nature, sin, sickness and disease, poverty and lack, when all the result of the curse of the law hit his body, Isaiah prophesied and said to look at him. He did not even look human. That Roman centurion had seen a lot of crucifixions, but at the end of it, he even said, surely this one, surely he is the Son of God. So there was something that was happening on that cross. So what this means is Jesus did not consider his equality with God something to hang on to. He was willing to take upon himself flesh and come and die for us. This means Jesus did not consider his equality with God something to hang on to at the expense of following and carrying out his Father's plan of redemption. He didn't hang on to it. He let it go. I would encourage you, let go of your own agenda. To ever fulfill the ministry, you got to get over yourself. Right? If you ever find yourself getting upset about something, you just immediately should just treat that like poison and go, hold on a second. For me to get upset, I got to be totally thinking this is all about me. And that's death, right? Jesus emptied himself. He said, my meat, my nourishment, my strength is to do the will of the one who sent me, right? I mean, you'd see Jesus at times, he's like, how long do I got to be with you guys, right? This shows us the way that we are to think, the mindset that we are to have. Everything I do as a pastor is not about me. Every time I've ever dealt with anybody in the ministry who's having a problem, they have always made it about them. To be honest with you, if you don't make it about you, you can't have a problem. So in other words, guess who the problem is? Right? I know in my life, if there's ever been a problem, guess what? It's me. Because you could be really done wrong and walk completely free if you're not about you. And God is saying, you think like this. Although you are born again and spirit-filled and heir of all things, Jesus, you are literally have been given everything. God loves you as much as he loves Jesus. Don't make this life on this earth all about you, right? There's something that God does everything by delegated authority. Everything he does is by delegated authority. Even the Trinity operates in this delegated authority. So we talk about submission to authority. Do you know God wants you to submit to the authority in your life? Right? Do you know how you're submitted to God is revealed in how you're submitted to your spouse? And I'm not just talking to wives, I'm talking to husbands. Because husbands love that one. Wives, submit yourself to your own husband. But there's other scriptures that says we're to submit to one another. And see, submission is not agreement, right? Why is it reflective? Because God's going to have you do some things that make no sense. He will have you, somebody will really do you wrong, and he will have you bless them. Or he'll have you sow finances into somebody's life that has 100 times more finances than you. I mean, I remember the Lord had me sow $20 into a guy in our church years ago. I was like 19 years old. I had no money. And this guy was a multi-millionaire. And I felt stupid. I'm like, I walked up to him after church and I said, hey, I go, the Lord just put it on my heart that he wants you to have $20. And so the guy kind of took it and kind of said, okay, well, thanks, you know. And then he came back to me a week later. And he said, you know, that blessed me so much because he had been talking to the Lord about sowing and all this other stuff. And God told him, he's going, I'm going to show you how this is going to work. And he said, when you came up to me and gave me $20, it wasn't like from you at all. I knew it was from God, that he was concerned about every little thing in my life. I had no idea. I'm thinking, well, you could give it back, right? You know, I didn't say that. Because you know, when God tells you to give something, guess what? It's not yours anyway, so you just give it, right? I remember Keith Moore was teaching one time in giving and receiving class. Well, I wish I would have really gotten that. And it was the first class I had at Rhema. Hour one, first day of class. I wish I would have listened because we went through so much financial trouble because of my own stupidity. But, you know, he would say things like this. He goes, you know, people would walk up to him and give him like a really nice watch. And then he would thank the person. And then he'd be literally walking out of the sanctuary like 5 feet away, it'd be like Pastor Edwin gives me a Rolex watch. And I'm like, wow, thank you, brother. And then I walk, and then as I take two steps, the Lord goes, okay, now give that to Pastor Mark. And so he would give it. He would turn around and give it because the Lord directed him. And sometimes the person would get mad. Hey, wait a minute, I gave that to you. Well, no. That's strings, right? We don't give with strings, right? No strings. Because you know why? Because Jesus, there were no strings. There's no strings in what we're talking about. A willingness that we are to have to offer a sacrifice of ourselves in the face of things that look better for us to fulfill the plan of God for our lives. Get out of this thing. You know, well, I don't know, you know, I'll pray about whether or not I should usher. Or I'll pray about whether or not I should, you know, maybe become part of the cleaning team. Or, you know, yeah, but Pastor Mark, you know, I know, I'll pray about whether or not I'm on the worship team. I mean, you know, I'm a professional vocalist and everything. But, you know, I'll pray about it because I don't know. Are you kidding me? You spiritual baby. You don't pray about that stuff. This is what the Lord told me when I was 18 years old. He said, just say yes. Had I not said yes all those years, I wouldn't be here today. Did I enjoy cleaning a daycare that was in a church? Wow. I did not enjoy that. Did I enjoy some things that I did? I didn't enjoy everything in ministry, right? I made it a joy. That's what I had to do. And see, you know, some people get into this, well, I'm called here. Listen, just follow the leading of the Lord. And this is the mentality that'll keep you right in the middle of the road. It's a willingness that you are to have, a mindset that you're to have to offer or sacrifice yourself in the face of things that look better for you so that you could fulfill, so the plan of God could go forward. Matthew 6:33 says it that way. Seek first the kingdom of God, and he'll add everything else to you, right? This is so important, this mentality. Am I trying to get you to do something in the church? No, we just believe God for that. And God just raises up people that love it and want it and all this other stuff. But the people that want to help, the people that God's able to use, they have this mentality. I'm willing to live my life as a sacrifice to see the kingdom go forward. So when I'm at work and the Lord tells me to go talk to this person, I'm of no reputation, so I'm going to go talk to them. If they laugh at me, it's okay, because I don't have a reputation. This is not about me. Your flesh will fight you on this. Only part of the day, day or night. Oh, that's the only time your flesh will have a hard time with that one, right? Jesus, in other words, he gave us an example on how we are to live. So now are you ready for verses 9 through 11? Because of what Jesus did, because of his attitude, because of his mindset of even though he was equal with God, he didn't count that. He took upon himself his self flesh. He literally laid down all of his godly glory. He took upon himself flesh. He lived as a servant. Now, because of that, look at what God did. Wherefore, God also, verse 9, hath, this is something past tense, highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. Do you know the name of Jesus is above every name? It's above debt. It's greater than bankruptcy. The name of Jesus is greater than divorce. The name of Jesus is greater than cancer. The name of Jesus is much greater than Alzheimer's or dementia, right? The name of Jesus is above every name. That at the name, verse 10, of Jesus, every knee should bow of things. In the Greek, it would read like this, of things or beings in heaven. At the name of Jesus, everything and every being in heaven must bow. And things, and it would read the same way, or beings in earth. Everything in the earth, everything and every being has to bow to who Jesus is at his name. Wow. And things, that's things or beings under the earth. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father. In other words, guys, because of Jesus, this is a new day. It's a brand new day. Sometimes days don't feel new, but it is new, right? Now Jesus, he has the keys of death and hell. When Jesus ascended into heaven, he transferred the authority that he had been given to his body, the church in the earth, you and I. You have literally been given the authority. You have the power of attorney to use his name, and everything in this earth realm, everything in heaven, everything under the earth has to bow to it. And you've been given his name. And everything must bow to it. So you don't have any problems. All you need is faith in God. All you need to do is believe that, right? It could change everything in your life. Jesus' authority, it must be perpetuated through his body, the church in the earth. The source of our authority is found in the resurrection and exalting of Jesus Christ by God the Father. God exalted him and gave, God the Father exalted him and gave him a name. I'm telling you, there's a principle here. If you will think like he is telling you to think in these verses over here, verses 5-8, God the Father will be able to exalt you above things that come against you in this life. It's a principle. Jesus got this authority back for us so that we would have authority in the earth. And we need authority in the earth because Satan is coming to steal, kill, and destroy. He has no power over you, but he's a master distractor and he's a master deceiver. And he'll try to ignite your flesh to get a door open so that he can move in your life, or he'll just move in your life and then you have to get him out of your life, right? But you have the name of Jesus to do that. Jesus is given a name above every name for the purpose of everything bowing to his name. Don't put up with stuff, right? The name of Jesus is above everything that you will ever face. If you're in a situation that it just seems like it's going a wrong way, you get before the Lord and you find out from him what you're to do. Realizing, but you're not trying to fight for a victory, you're fighting from victory. You are already a world overcomer. If you have sickness in your body, then you command it to get out of your body in the name of Jesus, and it has to bow. Situations in your work, situations in your family, you speak over them. Don't be flesh ruled that you just get upset at every little thing and your mouth starts going off, because Satan can steal from you that way, right? And this is why we have to have unlimited grace with each other. Because I'd love to tell you that you're never going to say anything stupid again and you're always going to just be in the perfect place, right? But no, you will. But can we just make Faith Family Church a safe place? Wherever you are, it's okay. We're going to love you. We're going to forgive you all the time. And we're going to expect for you to do the same for us, right? What a great environment that is. The early church, if you look at an aerial view of the early church records that we have, they used the name of Jesus on things, not on people. The name of Jesus conquers things, but the name of Jesus is not to validate you. Right? Now, I'm kind of speaking to my office, because sometimes pastors can start to begin to think that any of this is because of them. No. Anything good that happens or has ever happened or will ever happen at Faith Family Church is because of him. If it's not because of him, we don't even want it, because it will always end in death, right? The name of Jesus changes things. The name of Jesus conquers, is above all, changes everything to come in line with his word. That's what his name. That is who we're celebrating. Oh man, he was born as a baby in a manger, but he's not a baby anymore. Right? Jesus is given all the authority that Adam lost. So I love a statement by E.W. Kenyon. In his book, he said this: all that he was, all that he did, all that he is, and all that he ever will be is wrapped up in his name. When you speak the name, it comes on the scene. He comes on the scene. Right? I love that. So go to John chapter 14. Are we having fun? This is good. This is life-changing stuff. If you're not having fun, be happy for me. I am having so much fun right now. I'm loving every second of this. This is so much fun. I'm going to do it again after this is over, right? I can't wait to worship again. Wow. John chapter 14 and verse 12. Jesus talking here, he says this: verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believes on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. Don't focus on doing the works. Focus on believing on him. Because if you believe on him, you will do the works. It'll just be a byproduct. Why? It says here, and greater works than these shall you do because I go to my Father. Verse 13, and whatsoever you shall ask in my name. This word ask, again, is the Greek word eito. Whatsoever you shall call for, make a demand for, whatsoever you shall require, look at this, in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you shall ask, call for, require, make a demand for, look at this, anything in my name, I will do it. Do you see the oneness there? See, he's saying, ask the Father in my name. And then it says, and that will I do. Why? That the Father will be glorified in the Son. John chapter 16 says this. John 16, verse 23. It says, and in that day, you shall ask me nothing. This word ask literally means you will not make any requests or question me in that day. Verily I say unto you, whatsoever you shall ask, different word in the Greek, call for, require, make a demand for, the Father in my name, he will give it you. Hitherto, that's a wonderful Elizabethan English word. It literally means up till now. You have asked, you have called for, you've required, you've made a demand for, nothing in my name. But then he says, ask, call for, require, make a demand for, and you shall receive. Why? That your joy may be full. Well, why call for, require, make a demand for? Well, because he's already provided it for you. So what does it mean to require something? You get diagnosed with something, right? Let's say you get diagnosed, you have some kind of form of arthritis or something like that, or you have a problem, a disc that's bulging, or something in your body. What are you to do? You are to go. When did Jesus heal you? 2,000 years ago. He's already provided the healing. So now I'm just going to my Father. I'm saying, hey, Father, I require my healing. I thank you that Jesus redeemed me from the curse of sickness and disease. You sent your word and healed me. He himself bore my sickness and carried my pain. So I'm making a demand for it. Right now, I just believe that I receive my healing. I thank you for that, Father. That's what it means. The word ask, you got to be careful in the Greek because it literally means to call for, to require, to make a demand for. And you know, people will get mad at you for teaching that. I have firsthand knowledge of that. All dare you demand of God. No, I'm not demanding him. You better give that. No, I'm making a demand. Father, you already provided the healing. I need it now. In other words, it really, give us this day. Doesn't it say that? Give us this day our daily bread. In other words, Father, can you pass me my biscuits? Right? It's already my daily bread. I'll dare you tell God. No, he says that, right? Drop out of seminary and read your Bible, dude, right? I'm just joking. You know, I'm sure there's some good stuff in cemeteries that you can get. You know, did I actually say that with my outside voice? Anyway, no, there's probably some good there. Yeah. We better just move on because there's a lot of sticks, right, Jake? I mean, you know, yeah, we want to stay, eat the hay, leave the sticks. But there might be a whole bunch of sticks when you're talking about theologians. Anyway, let me just read this again and save myself. And in that day, you shall not question me about anything. Verily, I say unto you, whatsoever you shall call for, make a demand for, require the Father in my name, he'll give it to you. Up to now, you've called for, you've made a demand for, you've required nothing in my name. Call for, require, make a demand for, and you shall receive so that your joy will be full. Isn't that simple? So why did Jesus came? Why did Jesus come to this earth? He came to redeem us. He was given a name that's above every name. So now he's given us this name. We have been given this inheritance. But a big thing that Jesus came to do too is reveal the Father. It's amazing how people still don't know the nature of the Father after 2,000 years of a church age. John chapter 1 and verse 18 says this. John 1:18, no man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. This word declare means he hath drawn him out of the invisible shadows and showed the world who he is. In other words, if you want to see what God the Father is like, look at Jesus. Did he ever turn anybody away that came to him for healing? Never. Never. Did he condemn anybody caught in sin? No. Nope. If they came before him, he showed mercy. The Bible says as he would come, it said that he would heal all their sick, that just he was filled with compassion, mercy. He's showing us the Father. Did he enjoy the religious leaders of the day? No. If you want to see a side of the Father, he calls it the way it is, right? Jesus could declare the Father. Why? Because he had known and existed with him before ever coming to the earth. John chapter 14, go over here real quick. We're just kind of laying a foundation for all this stuff. John chapter 14, verse 9. Jesus said unto him, have I been so long with you, and yet you have not known me, Philip? So he's talking to Philip. He that has seen me has seen the Father. So how are you saying, show us the Father? In John chapter 10, I believe it's about verse 30, he even said, the Father and I are one. Do you know when we walk in this earth, we're to walk around saying, hey, listen, you don't have to say, show me Jesus. You want to live your life in such a way to where you could say to somebody, listen, if you've seen me, you've seen Jesus. Yeah. Right? And that's why if you ever don't show somebody Jesus, tell them, hey, I apologize the way I acted. That was out of line because that's not who I am. So please forgive me. Right? Why? Because it's not about us. It's about him. Right? I mean, I've heard stories where a pastor had a bad day and it sent a person's life on a mess forever. Have you ever heard of church splits and what people have gone through? You know, just displace people. Well, should they keep their eyes on Jesus? Yeah, but they don't always do that, right? But we live our life trusting him to live through us. And we have to be of no reputation. We have to be of no reputation. Don't try to promote yourself. Let God promote you, right? Just let him promote you, because it doesn't work very well any other way. Colossians chapter 1, go over here. Colossians chapter 1, we're kind of coming down the road here. You guys have done a real good job. This seems like I've been preaching like 5 minutes. You realize you've been listening for like 55 minutes. Now, maybe you might be sitting here going, I thought it was about an hour and a half, Pastor. No, I'm just, you know. But I'm not really asking, okay? So I just kind of live in denial in that area. That's right. I'll just say you're welcome. Right, there we go. Colossians chapter 1, verse 15. Talking about Jesus, he came to declare the Father. It says here, Colossians 1:15, who is the image of the invisible God. In other words, Jesus is the visible form of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. You're in Colossians 1, go to Colossians chapter 2 in verse 9. Look at what it says, for in him, in Jesus Christ, dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Wow. The mark of divinity, the characteristics of God were stamped upon Jesus. He was divine in his nature and in his being. He came to this earth to show people the Father. So now jump over to Hebrews chapter 1. Hebrews chapter 1, we're going to read the first three verses of this book. It says, God, who at sundry times and in diverse or different manners spoke in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days, do you know you're in the final of the last days, spoken unto us by his Son. He speaks to us by his Son. So if you get a prophetic word and it doesn't line up with the word, you got to throw it away. Right? I would encourage you, before giving somebody a prophetic word, I would encourage you to have at least 2 to 3 scriptures that you know back that up to make sure you're giving a correct word. Because everything in the word, the way God speaks to us in every way, like today, God is speaking to all of us through the word of God. Do we need the prophet? Absolutely, because that will equip us. We need all the 5-fold ministry gifts operating correctly with the correct mindset. But it's all going to be in line with the word, always, right? God, who at sundry times and in different manners spoke in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory. Jesus was the brightness of the glory of God. Wow. And the express image of his person. Jesus is literally the express image of God. And upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Wow. So I'm going to close with this scripture. Go to Galatians chapter 4. Galatians chapter 4, and we're going to read verses 4 through verse 7. It says this, but when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And because you are sons, God hath sent for the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, which causes you to cry, Abba, Father. That literally is Father, Father, Daddy, Daddy. Wherefore, thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. So you're an heir of God through Christ. And Jesus, the Bible we just read, he was an heir of everything that the Father has. Romans 8:17 says this, if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. So that means everything the Father has, the Son has. Everything the Father has and the Son has, you have. And you have his name. So that means you have all of his authority. All of that authority is backed up by relationship. So what I would encourage you to do is go change your world. Right? Let the power of God enhance your marriage. Let the power of God supernaturally protect your children as they grow up and protect that relationship that you have with them. Live as days of heaven on the earth. Do you realize when you drive, there's angels about you? There's angels that have been commissioned to go into the world system and get what you need. All of heaven is behind you. What Satan does is he tries to distract you or get you beaten down with natural circumstances so that you never know who you really are. I'm telling you, you could take the name of Jesus and make your whole life come in line with what he says. Amen. Every desire of your heart, the name of Jesus will bring it to you. Amen. So we're going to talk more about Jesus in the next few weeks. Amen.